Welcome everybody for this second part, which is where the first two sessions are 3D and docs oriented. So the component content management system. I think Alvin already kind of checked it out this morning. There's a mixed audience here, so we'll try to put something in for everybody that they have something to take away. So we'll find out how that goes, and we'll find out through the app if you liked it or not. So I'm Dave De Meijer. I'm a system architect on the 3D and Docs product line, and working for SDL already for quite a while. Seen a lot of things happen and change, and I can probably highlight some of those pieces in the upcoming slides.
Yeah, so my name is Ivo van der Lagemaat. I'm product owner for Tridion. I work for Tridion for about 19 years, I think. First started inside the content management part, later on I did mini manager. Then I become a product owner for sites, and now moving to the docs side of the Tridion suite. So this is my first presentation about docs, so be prepared.
Yeah, this is actually our dry run. Yeah. We never presented together. No. So
we love a challenge.
Indeed.
Okay, so in 1 hour we'll try to, what we'll try to do is illustrate the reason for existence. So why do you need Tridion docs? What is the added value? Bringing up to speed with some of the solutions of the concept that are common in Tridion docs. Also give you an idea of the persona user interfaces which are available in the Tridion docs. Little sketch, an overview about the architecture on the doc side, the integration points, and also show what's up in the new release for Tridion docs 14 SP1 that's coming out this year, hopefully. Yep. That's the plan.
Now we should
indeed. So the pain areas of technical documentation. So if you start a company, you start out with one product, and slightly it involves multiple products. And that includes, of course, multiple documentations as well for each of the products. Sometimes you also want to customize the communication to the audience. Maybe your brand is changing depending on the country, or maybe you're targeting a specific area in the world. So for miles, you have to make it kilometers, and from Fahrenheit, you have to create it for Celsius. It's also different ways of customizing your documentation. And then, of course, you have multiple editions of the same documentation. So look, for example, for the iPhone, started out with the iPhone 1 probably now already to version 11. And you keep all your documentation up to date for each of the editions. Besides that, we also want to translate your content as well. If you want to have a market, especially in Europe, there are multiple languages there, also in the US. So it's good to have your documentation ready in the language of the user you're targeting. And then, of course, you have also multiple outputs. Maybe you want to deliver it on a CD, like very old one, or maybe create a PDF out of it, or publish it on a website. And there as well, there's the complex workflow. So somebody can create content, but you need to have a review phase in there before it goes live to limit the amount of mistakes people make, or maybe for legal requirements, the documentation should be up to a predefined state, or to the review process. Everybody has to have the say in there, or maybe some review process has to be taken with all your colleagues before it is published. And then from that point of view, you can also revise it and maybe create extra additions or multiple additions from that documentation. So how do we actually solve this in Tridion docs? For the more and more products you're actually evolving, so you have maybe single sourcing and kind of reuse the mechanism. Maybe a lot of stuff you can reuse across your products. Think about also your legal requirements, maybe that it can easily be reused across all your products, and if you're making other kind of topics as well. For the customized communication, it's more like advanced personalization. It's something like I said for degrees and Fahrenheit and in your brand name. For multiple editions, we have the notion in Tridion docs of a baseline version. So you set up your structure and select which version of the particular topics you want in your output of the publication. We have also support for translations. We have powerful translations management system like TMS or World Server integrations. For multiple outputs, so for the data specification, you can create multiple outputs like PDF or make it available for the web. And for the complex workflow, it's more like a centralized repository for working together, like creating of the content, but also reviewing the content as well. Something about the system context. So how do you actually create your whole documentation? So you first start out with a plan, and then you use the publication management tool, and then you also define your workflow, and you specify the topics you want to include in your documentation. And of course, then select maybe the versions of each topic you want to in the final publication. And for the author, it maybe doesn't, we would like to use its own tools that currently, especially for the tech writers, they want to move Oxygen, for example, as an editor. We have some authoring bridge that is capable of working in that particular publication on the specific topic using those editors. We also have a review process and also the possibility to make annotations. And if from based on the annotations, you can change the content and approve it and agree with a lot of people in your organization what the final output should look like. And then we also have, once that's done, we also have to start the translation process. So when your final documentation is ready, you can send it out for translation and then put it back into the system and then publish it as well for different languages. Indeed, so the last step is basically everything is ready. You've finalized your topics, the whole review, the translation, and then you can actually publish it to the web or like PDFs. This basically is all based on the OSS data, the 3D docs, like creating those topics and maps. And then it's just indeed more like structured from the start, like indeed for Tridion itself, the Tridion site, for example, you can create schemas, but it doesn't say anything really about your structure. And with docs, it really specified in the specification for the data how your structure should look like. Bit of the introduction of, so data, like I said, is both a standard methodology and a structured way of writing your XML content. And then you can indeed write your topics, and in your topics you can put into maps, and then with the maps you also define your structure, how your whole publication should look like, and then from that point you can publish it in multiple outputs. Also have a notion of content types. So really, it is really granular. So it defines basically one question. And the power of it, of one question, is that it's really small. Everything knows what to do. So from the end position user view, it doesn't see it actually who writes it. It all looks the same. And doesn't matter which author created this particular topic. And if a topic can also be more like more specialized. It can have like a concept, task, or a reference. And it can even go further. You can even have specialized ones as well, task or references. So it's really like down to the detail, whatever you would like to be a topic, you can actually specify it with this specification. The core topics, types there are in OASIS is the task, the concept, and the reference. They basically have the same kind of header, basically have the same title, or they all have a title, and the short description, and a prologue, and the body is actually defined for the particular type. And they all look different, but sometimes they have similarities as well. So for example, the list. So for concept, it's really a list. And for a task, it's more like the steps you have to follow in order to complete the task. And for the reference, it's more like a property list. The OASIS data, of course, it's all based on the structure. And you can define your structure in a couple of ways. You can use DDD, so document type definition. You also can use schemas as well. They basically do the same, but not really 100% compatible. Both have their weaknesses and strengths as well. And now, indeed, for the new version, there's also a new standard, the OASIS Relax NG standard, is there as well for creating your documentation as well.
Well, yeah, and it's the leading standard where the DTDs and the schemas are derived from.
Yeah.
Avoids some issues from the past.
things. The solution contact concepts in docs. So the concept is basically a three-level hierarchy. So the whole system in 3D docs consists of cards. Cards is more like for a library with where you store your books with your ISBN numbers and stuff like that. In docs, you have the notion of something like a publication, a user, settings. And also the power is that you can actually link those together as well. You can reference those cards. And when you do the reference of those cards, you can create a nice hierarchy as well. So think about your topic, that is basically your top one. And that's, it has a reference, and that reference is based in GUID. And based on the particular topic, you can create versions out of it, version 1, 2, 3, 4. And then even you can go further, each version can have a language. And that way you have actually have the three level of your topic. So it's a main reference that you can use for referencing. And then you have the V1, V2, V3, that's really you can select from your baseline. And also for your output in a particular language, you can select the right language as well.
Yeah, and if I may add, the versions are actually about what is that message that we're trying to code in there. And we use a language to code that, either English or German or whatever, that expresses the message. But the idea is that the English and the German, if you know both languages, they state the same message. So that makes all of those languages siblings from each other to convey the message.
Indeed. The task does not change, basically.
Yeah.
Like I said, there's a concept also of linking those together. And linking, basically, you do on the GUIDs. It's more like the logical reference of those cards. And then later on, if you create a baseline for your publication, you actually select the particular version out of it, out of the particular topic. And then later on, you can also define your context as well. So there's maybe some conditions that you want to skip certain parts in your documentation, depending on a model, for example. Maybe if you want to write for a car, maybe some cars have an air conditioning, some have, don't have air conditioning. And that way, you can also filter out content as well with those conditioning.
Yeah, and if I may add again about the versions, sorry, Ivo.
It's okay.
In docs, the version is like really a primary citizen because if you look at how documentation stays online or stays in the field forever, everybody can think of a type of car where there are multiple editions live in the field, where even every older version of the car, even one from 1980, might still get a documentation revision. So that's where multiple versions are alive, and you also have branching on those versions to control all of that.
Oh, yeah. Indeed. And then also the notion of just-in-time language and resolution resolving. So when you actually start the publishing, and then maybe you have to run it for a particular language, maybe that language is not available, not translated yet. And then we can also fall back to a translation that is missing. So if you want everything is already available in English and you want to create a Dutch one, a couple of them are missing, then you can inherit from the English one in your output. So you don't have the broken documentation in the end. When that is done, we export it to a file system. Everything is then XML, the whole documentation. It also contains the graphics and extra metadata. And then from that point of view, we can actually generate the correct output, like a PDF or a web page as well.
Yep. So, high-level overview of the solution. We had a couple of rebrandings over the time, so there are some eras to be defined, but I think now we're on the 3D and Docs route, where we recently released 3D and Docs 14, introducing collective spaces, so that's something I'll touch upon, and that will also be touched upon in the coming days. These are all components or roles that we have in the system, but in general, and I see a mistake on the slide, all of these green and should be red as well. But we're continuing on all keeping it all together. So we're gonna have like a 3D and Sites content manager, there is a 3D and Docs content manager, and then there is a dynamic experience delivery component. So it's those three stacks that are connected and play their role in the whole content mashup delivery. For those unaware, the quick overview of the tools and their typical personas. We have a couple of fat client tools they're a bit like your Microsoft Outlook. You install it and you use your Exchange server or your Office 365 behind the scenes. But this is typically for users which are there for 80% of their time. So tech writers, some of you have that set up even for translation coordinators that you work with Publication Manager. So it's in the publication and definitely the tabs highlight that. It's over there that we define what the content is. So the flow, the outline of your documentation. The next step is the baseline where we are explicitly like, which version do we want? Could be a certain version one with a fix. So that means a branch on the first version. Variables, conditions, again, our reuse mechanisms to make that universal module an applied one for you. And then, we got it all together. And then you have various kinds of outputs because in the end, Tita is just a storage format that can go any way you want, actually. Everything is possible. Another fat client or where we integrate actually with fat clients is like Xmetal and Oxygen. So there's, again, for tech writers that are there for most of their day working and writing topics and that's really how it works. It's there that you really create that universal topic, put in the conditions, the variables, and work with it, work with creating content for the CMS. Condition Manager is not a mandatory tool, but it is a tool that is used usually by a smaller group that does a bit of governance, that allows you to pre-arrange some of the condition names and values. I think some of you know that Dita has a relatively strict set of five dimensions. With using the ISH condition, we allow any kind of condition names and values. Plus, we got more richer operators like in, and we can do version comparisons, and we can do date comparisons and numbers. So there are much more possibilities here that you can set up and later use. Content importer, where I put a small flag, a banner at the top to say that this is the one that is available already since 13SP2. We revisit the content importer quite a lot. It's a complete new experience with a lot more retry mechanisms and also restart, better console modes, all that kind of stuff is now there. It can do better legacy conversions, even changing some of your public IDs and all that. So it's a tool, again, by a select group of people that do the translations or that do a legacy import for some reason. So that's it's a tool that does a lot of heavy lifting.
Does that support binary files for import?
PDFs,
things like that.
It supports images. I have to get back to you if that means PDFs and stuff like that as well. Then the web client, which is kind of our explorer on the repository in a lightweight version in the web. It's there from the start, and that is holds a lot of the organizational bits like settings and user groups and workflow settings and all that, but it also allows you to really navigate that logical version language structure and see all of that in detail and check something out. Audience is typically more technical people. It's an extra UI that allows more deeper things. Something we are now adding in the general category of collective spaces is Draft Space, recently released. It's really a lightweight editing tool in the web. It's publication based, so you can open up a publication, you can create some new content in there, you can touch up, later we also have Review Space coming, that is later this year. And in Review Space, it gives you more a read-only view where you can have annotations to connect with your tech writers to like, we like this, we don't like this. And there are nice fancy comparisons coming on that.
Looks like this is a complete redesign from what was there before, so it's not X-Opus.
It's not X-Opus. It's a brand new component for us. Worth it. yeah, this is where the developer summit comes a little bit early because that's supposed to be pitched tomorrow and the day after. But yeah, it's a big change for us as the engineering team what we're working on and for you guys what might change in the deployment. So I have to highlight it in a bit here as well. We see draft space and review space, it opens up the audience. So we have more subject matter experts involved where we can actually invite them to write something from the start in there or where it's easier to have them review something and get into the direct communication. All the stuff I discussed so far is about filling up a content management database, but at some point you also need to get it out. We have the classics, the PDFs and all that, but there is also a delivery part of it, which is based on the proven Tridi Insights content delivery stack, now called Dynamic Experience Delivery. And we have a reference implementation on tap. We have a reference implementation on top of that, and that is an acceleration for you guys to get it working. So this is a screenshot of that. It holds the classic things of technical documentation delivery. So architecture. This is a screenshot from the documentation, but let me put some highlights in. So we have browsers and those rich client tools on the top left. Then typically we have an installation of a content manager. So there is an installation package. You install that, and those are the front-end servers. Those are the servers that give you immediate response. If you click on a folder, you expect to see the content of the folder. That kind of stuff can be easily put behind a network load balancer or an application load balancer. So all of the stuff that happens there has, of course, a connection to a classic database. And then that same installation package can also be used to set up backend server, also called batch servers. The things where you do some of the heavy lifting, more the fire and forget notions that I want this published, but it's gonna take, and I know customers where it takes 24 hours, that has to happen, so I'll just check the result later on. So that's piece of the puzzle. The full text index, although it theoretically can scale, but it's a full slave, and there is no reason, but typically it lives on one of the front-end boxes as well. Another kind of users are more the consumers of that content, where you have that web application that I showed you in the last screenshot. So that's the reference application on how to deliver documentation in the web. And then we have the proven backend of the dynamic experience delivery, so that we're reusing. And in this moment in time, I can refer to Arjen's session in the morning and to Ben's session, which comes later today. So, but yeah, picture looks kind of similar. It's a CMS and we have a delivery stack. We have various integrations that all have their reasons, so TMS and World Server or AcroLinks. On the security part, we still rely on WS Trust and WS Federation. Happy to discuss what you guys think the future looks like. So this is the supported standard. I think one thing I want to highlight from these slides is that although we out of the box deliver with a secure token service that directly links to the CMS as an identity provider, it's not our ambition to be an identity provider. So we still offer that as a for the smaller setups or as a backward compatibility option. But in the long run, we think that a separate identity provider and a separate secure token service, so that can be the Active Directories or some of the LDAP systems
which supports the standards, that's where we should go. Definitely if you're talking about high availability and scale out, if that's important for you, then that's the route to take.
Maybe it's also nice to mention that our vision basically is also to reuse some things about access management, both for sites and docs. Mm-hmm. So for 9.5, we're starting it actually on the sites part. We have lots of different ways of authentications across our services. We want to actually make it one internally, and then have some kind of access management that actually for the communication to your IDPs, basically. And that part we maybe also want to reuse in docs as well. That in that way you can also provision your users basically in one central point for sites and docs as well.
Yeah, indeed. This is a slide that I showed, I think, 6 or 7 years ago on a similar event like this. I think the world really went into that direction, so we were on the right track to be there already in 2012 or 2013. But yeah, we still apply the same scenario. Let's say, to zoom a little bit in on that Docs Content Manager architecture, if you install a box, a virtual machine, a server, then the bluish it holds the front-end part on the left, so the secure token service, the content manager, and the web services, and the back-end services, which are classic Windows services. That's what a box looks like. That are the roles we have. What we now added recently is the collective spaces endpoint, and that's where draft space and review space live. So notice that the installation package is the same. It doesn't mean that the license of the thing is the same. So, but installation-wise, the deployment is made easier than, let's say, our collaborative review world. And we're also going to add a couple of extra services that take care of things. So, for example, there is a position recovery service. So, if you make an annotation, a comment on some piece in the topic, then if you start editing the topic, then that paragraph might slip down or move up. Well, we will recover that annotation that it still points to the area where it should point to in the topic. But we will not push the annotation inside the topic. So the topic is still for the tech writers. The annotation is maintained separately with an addressing. And also comparisons are coming, giving some timeline overviews, which is definitely handy while reviewing. Again, a quick sneak peek, but this is draft space. So in draft space, it's about editing, and the review space has kind of the same layout. It's about reviewing your content, and it's not about about getting close to a PDF layout or something like that. It's not easy to see, but for example, this is one of our own specializations. It's called the API ref, but it can render API. It can render Oasis data specializations, and every page rendering is kind of a topic. So you get the feeling of kind of the classic book look, which still a lot of people like. On the right-hand side, you see the outline, which is kind of your map and nested maps. And there are two scroll bars that allow you to navigate through the document. Now, we don't load the full publication. That could be 10,000, some of you 50,000 topics. We don't do that, but the map is loaded and gives you an accurate scroll bar for the outline as well as for the pages of topics that you see on the left-hand side. We will have attributes, although I think that for this audience it's quite limited what you should offer here, because its attributes are usually a bit scary for people. So I would rather keep it empty than fill it up. And we have the properties, which is the metadata config-driven properties that a lot of you already know about. So that's single-sourced, one place of configuration for the client tools, for our content manager web client, and also now collective spaces. We do variable resolving, we do conref resolving, and we highlight conditions very similar to what you know of Publication Manager. It's limited to variables and conrefs.
Can you continue with the structured context management? So a little bit also, again, let Dave also highlight the CMA architecture. So we still have the customers, the browsers, and the risk clients talking to a load balancer. And then you have the front end for the context management bit, and also the back end, and everything then stored in a database. It is highly availability, so it also has it allows for auto scaling from the web apps, and we have also auto recovery as well through the product. Installation of the CM tools, it is quite easy. It's basically next and next finish. And if you do it for the first time, you have to set up your client, how to communicate, and that will actually be reused with the other add-ons you also install of the tools. It will download all the metadata, DET, and list once you use it for the first time. Installation of the content management server. So we have one database that should be installed, and we support Oracle and Microsoft SQL Server. And if you install on the Windows Server, we support the Windows 2019 and the 2016. And also the Oracle is 19c that we support this upcoming 14 SP1, as mentioned on the right top. We also support OpenJDK 11 and Oracle Java 11. Maybe that's also good to know for if you want to upgrade to this particular version. And installation is just like the usual, like all the other versions before. Easy installation from the command line. And for the upgrade of the database, you can still use the DB upgrade tool for doing all the upgrades and all the checks as well. The configuring of the content management part, everything that is configurable, it's in the UI. The list is quite extensive. It will grow as well, but yeah, but that's good. And like I said, everything is configurable. What is configurable, you can do it in this UI.
Yeah, we try to get everything into the database, but there are always some things historically that we have to keep on the file system for technical or performance reasons. But I think you get the idea that we try to consolidate, split business logic from layout, from configuration, and move down that path.
If you installed, then of course you're running the content management site, and there are a few servers that actually are installed. And one is like the background task. It's more like fire and forget. You give it an assignment, and then it will do its job. There's no state in there, but it will do its job, and it starts and it ends. And we solo the scene that actually enables it for the full text search, and actually the crawler maintains the full index. If you add, delete, or change the topic, or whatever kind of entity, it will update solo the scene to give you the right results. The translation builder and organizer to do all the translations for you. And then also a review service that for the annotations, for the positioning recovery, that was mentioned by Dave before. Besides the managed service, we also have roles, and one of them is like the CM CM role, is like the content manager role. We have the web service role, like the STS for the secure token service, and there is the new one is actually for collective spaces. That is for the draft space and the review space. And that is part of the content manager. Something about the background task is basically the fire and forget task. It can handle also long-running tasks, like we mentioned before. If you have a publication that consists of maybe 50,000 topics, it will take a while to get a final output. It runs in its own memory. It's an isolated process, so it doesn't actually not destabilize your current content manager if you're using the web interface. It is also configurable with kind of backer star service can be picked up, and also how long it will take in all those kind of settings. It will make your background task scalable, and also it is scalable, and also you can define how long it will take as well. So we also have the notion of recovery time as well. So we can give the background service a task, and also a particular amount of time that is expected to be handled that task. It's more like a leash line. If you extend the leash, then it will, after a certain amount of time, it become available for the background task to be picked up again. Basically, then something went wrong. It's the notion of the leash. So if the leash will expire at a certain point of time, like I said, it will be picked up again. If it is handled in a particular time frame, it will mark it as deleted, it is final, it won't be picked up by the background task again. And yeah, like I said, you can configure it, how long it is, and it will work successfully. The extension points. We have a couple of extension points. It's mainly for the consulting. In the extension points, it's the information about the architecture and the specializations. And we have a couple of ways having those extension points available. We have the public web service. It's like it is the web service that powers all the client tools. So we also validate our own web service well, does it do the right job? And all our client tools are actually using that particular web service. So we also confident that it is working. It also supports like the background task as well, like the fire advocate. We have some plugins for the handling of to submitting metadata and some on blob handling, and especially also the metadata binding for going to external systems for some extra metadata as well. And also, of course, like I mentioned before, we also have the Altering Bridge SDK that allows us to integration with XMetal, for example, or Oxygen to edit your topic in your tool that you like. The public SOAP API, so I will mention that just before, it is used by the majority of our client tools. And it's basically around classes about the objects of your documentation, of your topics. It has notion about the publication output as well. And it also, it supports currently WF SOAP. And we have still an AMX SOAP one, but that one is deprecated. So
it's still there.
It is still there.
I'd like to get rid of it.
It works, but we strongly encourage you to use the WGF SOAP service. Currently. The CM public SOAP API compared to the alternative. So on our documentation, it's at docs.sgl.com, you can find the documentation about docs. And it is particularly for the SOAP server, you can see all the basically the methods and when they're introduced and if they're still supported or deprecated. We maintain every version for docs, we maintain this metric, so you can also find for previous versions how it looks like, and this is the current one for the latest version. We also have the content manager, the iWrite plugin. So in order to write something, you can hook in your own basic functionality that you are aware of it, that something is written. And then you can also basically your own business logic a little bit, or write to a disk or whatever. If you say I contend it, or you introduce your own validation rules, you can actually abort the whole transaction, and then it is never saved, basically. Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah. It basically works no matter what tool you use. So you can use the web interface for adding your topic, or like a client tool like Oxygen, or any other tool. It's still implemented in a business logic, so it is always executed no matter which client is adding this particular topic. And it can also launch a background task if it's long running and time consuming. This is a list of out of the box write plugins. So we have it more or less for content objects, annotations, and publications. And that list is also available on the documentation portal. Then we also have for content manager the iMetadata binding. And this is particular if you want to have a field in your topic, for example, that links to a external source. And you can think of an external source for a taxonomy, for example, where you make the reference to it. And we only store the reference, not the value. So when we actually display it for you, we retrieve the value and show it in the list. This is basically also the for the client tools. So this is the metadata binding. You can also define how you want to display it for a tree view, auto-suggest, or filtering. And you can also show it for text as well. This is more based about the flow, like I was currently mentioning. So if you select something or display it, or you have selected something and want to display it again in your in the UI, it will pick up the reference from our content manager database. And from that point of view, we code actually to the metadata binding to the remote system, get the value out of it, and we'll fill all the tags or the elements you would have in the list without not showing the ID, but actually the real value. Most of the time, the ID doesn't say anything to the user. They want to see the value. Also, we start like the suggest mode for start typing. So in that way, we can actually go to the external system, look up all the data that is start with this particular text, and we'll display it in a list of suggestions people can select the right value from. If you want to do the arrow down for more for tree structure, we also don't load the whole list, but basically if you move down your arrow, we can also go to the external system, get the right list, and we'll display it for you, and you can make your selection or navigate further. We also have the filtered browse mode. So that is also if you have a selection, basically the list is there, but you can start typing and it will limit your list where you can choose from. And when you save a property, like I said, we don't save the value, but the reference. And that also, yeah, that's the only way we can actually allow people also to change the label as well. Because the reference is basically a unique ID, and the value can change. You can also have another language for that as well. We also have the background task. The background task is more or less what I said before. It's more like it's also a queue mechanism. It's the fire and forget principle. It will queue all the tasks. It will run them one by one. Also with the least time as well.
Yeah, this is the interface of the handler of the messages. So our generic background task server can then trigger the right handler for the message that is on the queue. That's what this one does. And then yeah, one of the bigger heavy lifting pieces is publishing, of course, which I want to quickly touch on for some of you that are not yet on 30 SP1 or higher. We did a publishing overhaul, so a lot of publishing is key in the application, no doubt about that. But yeah, it was also due after many years that we had to start from scratch and get it fully implemented again. So on the left-hand side, that you see that in certain situations we were half or even like a lot faster for certain setups, and it's definitely worthwhile in upgrading on that. Now there is also some effort involved. So if you look at the pre 13 SP1 era, then publishing looks something like this. You had a publish service, so the one responsible to get the right versions and languages and fallback languages from the baseline onto your file system. And then post-processing started. And post-processing, that was about a train of VBScript. And VBScript is not necessarily the language anymore that a lot of the youngsters want to keep up and maintain. So it was due for a replacement. Plus, it's a scripting language. And that is
in essence, not very fast. So this all now became a compiled language, which gives us immediately several options like multi-threading and all that. So a lot more modular approach and kind of wagons on a train. Another thing I want to highlight is that since this version, that the whole retry mechanism is respected for publishing. So background task introduced that several releases ago. Now, really, if the publishing ends with a specific error, you can configure for that specific error if it should retry or not, and how many times it should retry. So that's definitely a bonus in certain situations that it doesn't loop forever. Another thing that happens is that in the old publish service, we kind of dropped everything which is in the baseline on the file system. In the new one, we follow the map structure. So if suddenly in the map there is a condition that says this part of the tree is not valid, we don't even go and put it on the file system. So that means that you see in the event log, which is on the right-hand side, so that's our centralized database logging, you see that it starts with one item, and then the first level of the map, the second level of the maps, and then all the way to the leaves, which are typically the libraries or the images. So it's a breadth-first traversal that we do, respecting conditions. So these are all things that happened, and that we get the performance increase from. So this is the reference picture. I'm not going to fully explain it, but there are interfaces here on the right-hand side, how to get a wagon on this post-processing train. Also, the comparison engine can now be implemented in a different way. So if you have your own custom comparison engine, you can do that now. The end result is still under our control, and we upload it to the repository if said so. So a bunch of interfaces. I don't really want to highlight it here. You can pause the video. So of course, to kind of have compatibility with the VB script style way of things, we implemented already a lot of standard plugins for you, things that are required. So these are all listed. They have an ISH prefix. And then also referring to the content mashup, so reuse of the Tridion Sites content delivery platform. We have a lot of prefixes, which at the time of writing, we prefixed them with Dita delivery. But yeah, afterwards, the branding changed a bit, and it became all DX and DXA kind of stuff. So, but that's the reference for you guys. So once we have that publishing done, then we can get that in that content delivery stack. This is a quick reference. Ben Middleton later today will give a little bit more insight, but this is the high availability stack. So our front end, many microservices, and storage in the database. That's the high level overview if you need to quickly draw it on a whiteboard. And that kind of brings us to the end of this presentation. So in a few moments, there will be a new presentation starting, and that will do a bit more about deployment and automation.